Good evening and welcome to the regular City Council meeting of Monday, June 11th, 2018. At this time, can we have the roll call, please?
Councilmember Durossette?
Yes.
Councilmember Lane?
Here.
Vice Mayor Kline?
Here.
Councilmember Ryno is absent. And Mayor Vierra?
Here. Next, we'll move to the invocation by Chris Grigson from the Valley Christian Center, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance.
Amen. Dear God in heaven, we thank you for your goodness. We pray that you would watch over us today. I pray that you would give wisdom and counsel to our mayor and city council, Lord God. I pray that you would just give peace over these proceedings, and I pray that your will be done. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. We have a couple of presentations this evening. The first one is a proclamation declaring the month of June as Disability Awareness Month in the City of Ceres. I think Carolyn Texera Gomes will be here. Okay, I do have a proclamation of the City of Ceres proclaiming June 2018 as Disability Awareness Month, whereas the City Council of the City of Ceres have recognized healthy communities as a priority, and disabilities can affect all people regardless of race, age, gender, or social status, and the essence of life is not embodied by physical or mental perfection, but is an integral part of the human spirit. And increasing public awareness about diverse abilities, is vital to fighting the stigma and discrimination that often serves as a barrier to employment, socialization, and individual well-being. And whereas there is an estimated over 4 million people with disabilities in the state of California, and over 68,000 people over the age of 5 with disabilities in Stanislaus County, and whereas within the next year, at least 1 out of 8 Californians will experience a disability personally or through a family member, and whereas the City of Ceres wants to celebrate and recognize people with different abilities, and whereas people with different abilities are independent, productive, and part of the community, and whereas education, understanding, engagement, and relationships are important components of a connected, viable, and healthy community, and whereas communities thrive when residents appreciate the unique gifts inside people of all abilities, and whereas by developing relationships with our neighbors, we make our community a place where everyone participates and is a valued member, and whereas the Society for Disabilities will commemorate June 2018 and June thereafter as Disability Awareness Month. Now, therefore, let it be proclaimed by the City Council of the City of Ceres that June 2018 is Disability Awareness Month within the City of Ceres, and we urge all our citizens to become more aware of the needs and capabilities of persons with disability. Proclaim this 11th day of June 2018.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, City Council. And on behalf of the over 65,000 people in Stanislaus County that have a disability, thank you. For 8 years, June has been declared Disabilities Awareness Month, and our theme this year is See the Abilities in Everyone. You will see this throughout our Facebook posts, our speaking presentations, as well as our programs this month, which include our Day on the Farm, the Miss Stanislaus Spirit Princess pageant, which, by the way, the best friend in our last pageant was from Ceres, and then, of course, our adaptive water ski. The Society for Disabilities for over 70 years has enhanced the quality of life for people with disabilities. Every day, we keep our See the Abilities in Everyone theme. We think Stevie Wonder says it best. We all have ability. The difference is how we use it. We help people use their abilities through our durable medical equipment loan closet and our recreational and social programs. Through our programs, people with disabilities increase their independence and are included in activities never thought possible for them to participate. We provide the opportunity to water ski, winter ski, ice skate, ride a horse, bowl, be a princess, play baseball, or go to a prom. Activities that most parents never thought their child with a disability would be able to do. And yes, with the right equipment, volunteers, community support, we see every day there is ability in every disability. So on behalf of the over 65,000 people with a disability in our county, this proclamation is greatly appreciated. Thank you for your help to increase awareness of disabilities. And we at the Society for Disabilities wanted to remind you one last time to see the abilities in everyone. Thank you and have a great evening.
Thank you. Okay, next we have the Ceres Street Fair presentation.
Lisa Mantero Moore, Ceres Street Fair. I have a number of our committee members here. You guys want to join me up here, or are you going to be comfortable sitting? Looks like they're comfortable sitting. So we have just completed the 30th annual Ceres Street Fair. It was wildly successful. Actually, before tonight's meeting, we had our wrap-up meeting, which actually occurred a little bit sooner than it usually does. We're very pleased with the success. We've had nothing but positive comments. The downtown revitalization made a huge difference. We had a lot of challenges and modifications we had to do to achieve our goals for the street fair, and we exceeded them. So in the spirit of the fact that it's an anniversary year for Ceres and it's the 30th anniversary for the Ceres Street Fair, I thought it only appropriate tonight to recognize our committee members, but also our first street fair chair, Paul Caruso. Thank you, Paul, for joining us tonight. You really set a huge standard. What people on the council may not realize, or the people that work for the city, is how much work goes into the street fair. People that work for the city of Ceres work for the city every day, and they're usually on the paycheck. No disrespect to that, but the fact is there are people that give to the city of Ceres outside of their paychecks. They do it outside of their time, their family's time, their commitment, and they spend a lot of time putting the street fair together. It takes months of planning, months of time that's unaccounted for, and sometimes not dealing with the most pleasant of customers, but nonetheless, we have a commitment to this community, and we have kept the street fair intact for 30 years. In the same spirit of which it was originally designed. And we do that maybe with some assistance from folks, but the city doesn't run this program, we do. The Ceres Street Fair is its own nonprofit committee, and those people that work on that Ceres Street Fair do it as a commitment to their community and a labor of love, speaking for myself as well as those included. Our committee members include the following, some of which are here with me this evening. Representing the Ceres Lions Club, we have council members Lane and Durossette. We also have Rocky Fisher, Randy Moore. We have, from the Ceres Chamber of Commerce, thank you Juan Romo, president, for being here tonight. Renee Ledbetter, Brandy Meyer. We also have them, a number of committee members who work outside of any affiliation, which is Kim Chapman Johnson, wow. Dave Johnson, Eric Ingerson, he's kind of hard to define in any group. and our parade committee members, Helen and Angie. We put a lot of time into this, and I'm really proud of the work that they've done this year, and these people do it every year, and they're waiting for the year to come back. So I wanted to acknowledge in the city records that the 30th Street Fair is closed. We did great, it's good, and we're looking forward to next year.
Thank you.
You guys want to stand up at all?
Thank you, Lisa. Next, we will move to citizens' communication to matters not included on the agenda. While the City Council welcomes and encourages participation in City Council meetings, adopted rules allow no more than 5 minutes for expression of non-agenda items. Matters under the jurisdiction of the City Council and not on the posted agenda may be addressed by the general public. However, California law prohibits the City Council from taking action on any matter which is not on the posted agenda unless it is determined to be an emergency by the City Council. Citizens are entitled to address the City Council on any agenda item subject to the five-minute provision. I've got a few speaker cards, and I'll call on those. But before I do that, I just wanted to make a couple of comments. I know that there's a number of people in the audience that might want to speak on the budget and public safety, fire, et cetera. It's not on the agenda this evening. You're welcome to speak, but we cannot address it or speak to that because it's not on the agenda. That will be addressed at our next upcoming meeting, and there will be public comment period during that, and you will definitely be given that opportunity to speak at that. So I just want you to know that if you don't get any reaction out of us tonight, it's because we can't address the item. So I just wanted to let everybody know that. Again, it's not on the agenda tonight, and we haven't been provided any budget information since the last time we had the discussion, so we're still trying to get through that information. So with that, the first person that I will call up is Ann Thatcher.
Hello. I wanted to talk to you about Ceres Fire Department. I live on the other side of 99, and I feel like we are kind of the stepchildren of the City of Ceres. We don't have a single council member that lives over there, and I think that we get underrepresented, even though Linda
That's
Ryno,
changing. This election, we go to district elections, you will have someone that's from that district.
That's really exciting, mm-hmm. but that doesn't affect what's happening right now and the things that you guys are considering that will directly affect me in the near future and my home. So with that, I'm talking about Station 4, which you also refer to as Station 17, and I understand you cannot talk about it, but I just want to kind of bring a resident's viewpoint to the council so that as you start pondering these very difficult decisions that you're making, that you take that into consideration, what I have to say, because if I need to walk precincts and that kind of thing and get signatures, I can do that. Mr. Lane can attest to that. There are a significant number of residents that live over on our side of 99. We have, I guess, a population of 45,000 people in our city right now. I'm not sure how many live over there. It's in the news that cannabis is providing much needed sales tax dollars, and I understand Ceres is no different. So with that, I wanted to make sure that you take into consideration, if you start considering reducing fire services, that's gonna affect our ratings of our fire hazard insurance, because we're not gonna have the response times that maybe we once had. I'd also like to point out that my understanding is that Measure H is a part of funding of our fire department, as well as the general fund dollars. And when you start contracting out services, you lose control, which does hurt the citizens. So with that, I think if you start doing that, and I understand we already have resource sharing, and my home would be covered by the City of Modesto, but I know the City of Modesto residents don't want them responding if there was an emergency to my home in Ceres, because they're paying for their fire services. So with that, again, I would like to request you reconsider the closure of 17, also known as Station 3. I know it's been closed for some time now already, but I understand that maybe another station, Station 2, I'm not sure what station number that is in the whole county scheme of things, but that's the Pecos station, would further strain our services and would make Station 1 having to be respond over there. So I'm just want to lay it out there that I'm a citizen that lives over there, and I want to be heard, and I don't want you guys to forget about us over there on 99, on the other side 99. Thank you.
Dan Thatcher? What, I'm sorry? Okay. And again, at the next meeting, you'll have opportunity to speak just like this, and we will be addressing the item. So again, if you don't see any comments from us, again, because we can't address it because it wasn't agendized. Avery Jackson?
Hello, everybody. First off, I want to thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak and voice my concerns. My name is Avery Jackson, and for the better part of the last two decades, my family and I have been extremely active members in the Ceres community. In that time, we have poured our hearts into the many different youth sports and programs that Ceres has to offer, and have volunteered countless hours into supporting, strengthening, and mentoring the children that have been a part of those programs during both the season and during the off season. In the last 8 years, we have donated our time and resources into the young adults at the high school level, and have spent the last 5 years helping those young adults push towards college and military careers. We have focused on and spent hours in the community and neighborhoods that most people wouldn't even allow their kids to walk through, and some adults even feared driving through, because we see and know the needs of those children and families and do our best to have those needs met. In my family, we are firm believers that it takes a village to raise a child in the way that it should go, and we strive every single day to be that village for the children of Ceres that are lacking a village of their own. Though we have not spent much time in the city council meetings before this, we are no strangers to the community, because our time has been spent in the trenches supporting the children and future of this community. And I am here today because I feel as though the future that we and many others like us are striving to build is currently in danger. That might sound drastic and alarming because of the recent cosmetic updates that the city has undergone that has made our city even more pleasing to the eye, but there is no remodeling, planting, flower planting, or sidewalk paving that can be done that can cover up the problem that the citizens of Ceres are facing. As a citizen of Ceres, I believe that we are suffering from a lack of police enforcement. In today's day of social media and scrutiny, it would probably be deemed as strange for a black man to stand before city council and, instead of complaining about cops, be complaining that we do not have enough of them and we are not paying them adequately to do the job. But that alone shows the severity of our problem. Plainly speaking, this city by no means has enough cops patrolling the streets. Over the last couple of years, this city has gotten rid of at least 10 police officers' positions. Though as a citizen, I can understand budgeting and the need for cuts here and there. I do believe in the concept of mandatory spending, and I would think that the safety of our citizens should fall into that category. One major thing that our city is lacking is a real street crimes unit and an officer in the drug, gang, and auto task forces. Without these real forces, we have officers that are forced to try and combat the many different drug problems in our community, and all the while taking their normal service calls. We have the officers taking on hero duties, and if we're being really honest, we do not pay these officers enough to run around here being Superman. Ceres has one of the lowest paying wages for officers, and our city is suffering firsthand from it. Our police department can hardly get applicants because of how low our wages are and our extremely lack of special assignments. We have zero. Currently, most of the applicants that we have received have either been released on probation or quickly find another place to work because of the same lack of money and special assignments. It has been over 10 years since the police department has seen a legitimate pay raise. However, in just the last 10 years alone, the cost of living has gone up 22%. All the while, what little money we're supplying our officers with, they hardly see. Currently, our newly hired officers are forced to pay 14% of their checks towards their retirement, and this, their mandatory 7.5 to both Social Security and Medicare. So before taxes are even removed from an officer's check, 22% of their check has already vanished. After taxes, between 40 to 50% of their check is already gone. In a city with the history of Ceres' war against drugs and gangs, I cannot find a logical reason that would prevent us from developing a street crimes unit. Recently, there was an officer who had to write a warrant while out on patrol that led him to seize 1.3 pounds of meth and two firearms. While this is a great victory for that officer, and we applaud his ability to successfully work in a system that is not supplying him with the tools that he needs, this officer should have not been placed in that position.
Mr. Jackson,
this is a job that our street crimes unit should be handling.
Could I have you finish up the 5 minutes? Is Are you getting close?
Yeah, I'm almost
okay.
Done.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Sure.
While many are satisfied with the answer that these special task forces do not exist because we do not have the money to fund them, we are not. With the funding of Measure H, we were told that the money would be used for the improvement of the police, fire, and 911 emergency services. To date, we are still looking for those improvements that would be made. Instead of real tangible improvements with the funding of Measure H, we have been given the whisperings of the city supplementing the general fund with the Measure H money. But even with Measure H money aside, there are still more things that we could be doing as a city to improve the current police force situation. For example, in our lovely small town, we have 4 fire stations. The city has shut down one, but we need to shut down another. Right now, the North Fire Station handles a lot of the Ceres firefighter calls, but the majority of their calls are in the county's jurisdiction. The county only pays the city around $200,000 to man the station. Meanwhile, it costs the city close to $1.5 million to keep the station open. The city could be making a profit by renting the station out to the county and having them man it and saving the $1.5 million that we are putting into it. On the same note, it would be the best interest of the city to bring back the volunteer firefighters position. Not only is this role in the city something that boosts the overall morale of the city and provide unity in our community, but this role would be vital to helping undermanned stations stay afloat. There would be hundreds of applicants from the community that would pride themselves in helping man the fire stations and responding to calls for free, even if it's just to say that they are firefighters and take a ride in a big red truck. They can help us get the job done, so why are we not using the tools in our toolbox to get the job done? In conclusion, the real takeaway here is our plea for the funding and improvement of our police force. With the overall lack of police presence, the children in the community feel neither safe nor protected. Though I cannot speak specifically about the neighborhoods that you all live in, but I know that if you were to walk through our neighborhoods, you would have a much better understanding for the everyday mental strain and stress that these children experience. At the end of the day, we believe it is all about the kids in the community. These children right now are the future of this community, and I urge you to take the necessary steps towards protecting and investing in their future.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to speak to the council on a non-agenda item?
Dave Pratt of Ceres. This is one of the few times I get up here I'm not complaining about something. But I'm promoting our nonprofit Veterans Employment Committee, our first fundraiser, drive through Texas Roadhouse. July 24th from 4:30 to 6:30 p.m., $15 per ticket. What they got is pulled pork and barbecue ribs, buttered corn, fresh baked bread, and honey cinnamon butter. So I put some flyers over here if anybody's interested. Thank you.
Thank you.
Leonard Shepherd. All of I've heard so far is kind of gloomy, but I got something exciting. Last Tuesday was the first concert in the park. It was pretty good. As a matter of fact, I even saw the mayor there, Mr. Wells. I was looking around to see where everybody else was, but I saw the great Caruso. He can't sing worth the darn like his namesake, but he was there, and he was selling T-shirts for the 100th anniversary. And I thought, that's really great, so I bought my wife one. I'm having a lot of fun with this concerts in the park stuff. Now, I want you, all of you, to be there on July 10th, because I'm going to be the MC and the host. And it's going to be a bang-up, whiz-banger doozy of a concert. It's going to be the Gottschalks Orchestra and the Pledge of Allegiance, and the presentation of the colors is going to be by the VFW, post 10293. They're going to actually bring the colors in front of you so you don't have to turn around and try to find that big old flag in the back corner of the park, or the front corner. I'm not sure which it is. But anyway, it's going to be a real lot of fun. And I am glad to see that people in Ceres are coming out to these things, because they're a lot of fun. And you know what the cost is? Zero. It doesn't cost you a thing to bring some chairs or blankets or ice chest full of goodies or whatever. And it's fun. It's free, it's fun, and we have some good fun with it and some good music. Some of the music sometimes is not everybody's cup of tea, but it's still, you get to see people. First time we ever met Juan Romo was at Ceres concert in the park. He was there with his family. I didn't realize he was going to be the president of the Chamber of Commerce, but that's... So come out on Tuesday nights through July, June and July, and have a great time. And say hello to everybody and see the people that sometimes you don't always see. People like Lee and Sheila Brandt are always there. They're always here. So we have a great time. And yes, we need a lot of more money and everything, but we just got to do what we got to do. And this is a break from all of the headaches and everything. So come on out and have a good time.
Anyone else?
Hi, my name is Josh Steele, and I live here in Ceres, so that's why I'm here. I saw something that concerned me that was released from the Ceres Fire Association, and I came today as a concerned father and a concerned citizen of Ceres. I know that in March there was the option to give back federal dollars at an amount of $320,000 because the difference would have cost $30,000. But I know in that same month we also approved a $100,000 lawnmower for the Parks Department. So I feel that the closure of the Firehouse 2 could have been avoided. And I also heard that the additional firehouse that is on proposed to be closed as well. And I just wanted to voice that I do not support that direction, because I feel it puts my family and other families in Ceres at risk and in danger. And I'm willing to see my park's lawns go uncut, but not my family's fire and police protection to be cut. Thanks. Thank you.
Anyone else?
Gene Yakeley, Ceres. July 4, 2018 is just 28 days away, and I would like to hear what the city of Ceres has planned on keeping our city safe and comfortable for its citizens during the time leading up to the 4th of July and the day of the 4th of July. It was discussed in the not-so-distant past to ban fireworks in Ceres. I believe this should be considered once again. I believe that this should be, no, excuse me, this the problems it causes to the fire department, the police department, and the citizens, and for those with animals in their homes, these are the issues. I suggest the city council implement a ban on fireworks in Ceres and consider renting street highway message boards that would flash two messages. The first message being all fireworks prohibited, and the second message, $1,000 fine. Place these signs at the entrance to Ceres at Hatch Road and Highway 99, Mitchell Road and Service Road just off Highway 99, and Whitmore Avenue just off Highway 99, and Mitchell and Hatch close to the bridge crossing the river coming to Ceres. Times have changed, and many other cities and counties in California have banned fireworks. Maybe the city has message boards to use. If the city does not have access to such signs, they can be rented at United Rentals in Modesto. They run about $319 a day for one message sign and requires a deposit to book them for a particular date. Now is the time to book those signs and to place that deposit. Let's end this madness of the crazy experience of the 4th of July in the city of Ceres and have a comfortable celebration of the 4th of July for once without all the problems. The violators have learned nothing and have turned our city into a free-for-all of anything goes. Aerial fireworks, bottle rockets, mortars, M-80s, etc. Just name it, and it's probably been fired in Ceres. And even gunfire. Maybe the city should just post a sign entering Ceres that says, "Enjoy July 4, 2018 in Ceres. Fire, shoot what you bring." Let those who wish to experience fireworks go to an event where it is safe for all. These suggestions are not to punish those who enjoy the 4th of July. It is just time to change. Will it take a serious accident or death before the city of Ceres can see the light? I hope not.
Anyone else would like to address the council on a non-agenda item?
Dan Thatcher, live in Ceres, other side of town, with my wife. Spoke earlier regarding the fireworks. It's the safe and sane fireworks are the ones that we should keep legal. It's the ones that are the bottle rockets, the sky rockets, the cakes, whatever you want to call them, that you sell at the swap meet. My daughter's boyfriend was at the swap meet just yesterday and called her and told her that they were selling illegal fireworks there, and I don't want to get too much into it, but anyways, they went over and purchased some, and they shut them down real quick. My suggestion is that flea markets, they fine the people that are selling the illegal fireworks. The owners of the flea market are fined for allowing them to sell the illegal fireworks, not the non-safe and sane fireworks. But to keep the safe and sane fireworks for the football teams, Brett, you know as well as I do, make a lot of money on that, and for the schools and band and churches and things like that, they make a lot of money off the sale of fireworks. So I think we should keep those legal, but just crack down on the illegal fireworks. That's about it. Thank you.
Anyone else? Okay. Just a reminder again, at our next meeting, which is in 2 weeks, which is on June 25th, Monday, we will have the budget discussion where we will be addressing not only some of the things that were brought up in public comment period, but the budget in general related to the general fund, which, by the way, is police, fire, and parks and recreation, as well as all of the other departments. So I would encourage you to show up for that meeting and speak as well. You'll all have an opportunity to do that. So with that, we will move on to appointments to boards and commissions. We have none. Conflict of interest declaration. Is there anyone on the council that would like to declare a conflict of interest on any of the 11 consent calendar items? Okay, hearing none, we'll move to consent calendar. All matters listed on the consent calendar are considered routine in nature and will be enacted by a single motion unless otherwise requested by an individual council member or the public for special consideration. Otherwise, recommendation of staff will be accepted and acted upon by roll call vote. At this time, is there anyone on the council that would like to have one of the consent calendar items pulled for further discussion?
Item 11.
I'm sorry, which one?
11.
11, okay. Anyone else? Okay, is there anyone in the audience that would like to have an item pulled other than item 11? Okay, I'll bring it back to council for direction on the first 10 items.
Move for approval of 1, 2, 3, A, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Can we have the roll call vote, please?
Councilmember Durossette?
Yes.
Councilmember Lane?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Kline?
Yes.
And Mayor Vierra?
Yes.
Motion passes 4-0-1.
Thank you. Item number 11, resolution number 2018-065, authorizing the city manager to execute the consultant agreement amendment number 9 with NV5 for the service Mitchell interchange plans, specifications, and estimates. Vice Mayor Kline.
Are we using any SB1 or Measure L funds for this phase?
For this phase, we are not using SB1 or Measure L.
Okay. So my next question is we will be using SB1 and Measure L funds for the construction.
That is correct. As you know, with Stancog, they have not allocated those funds yet to us for our large project.
And that is going to be a regional project, not a city project.
Yes, sir, that is correct. That's how it's funded through Stancog.
I'm just trying to make sure that it's a regional project and not a city funded, so their Measure L funds will be used for what we need to do within the city. And the other regional projects, which would be the Service Mitchell Road Interchange.
That is correct.
I just want clarification.
Okay. Any other questions? Any questions in the audience?
Jerry Galeazzi, 3700 Collins, Space 15. As far as the interchange, my question is there any time frame when the area around it is going to be incorporated in the city as far as fences, sidewalks, and all that?
For the interchange itself?
Well, the area all around the interchange, yes. It's my belief that's all going to be incorporated into the city limits.
Yes, an annexation will be processed to incorporate that area around that. It has actually gone through the Planning Commission already. We're waiting for the environmental documents to be completed through Caltrans before we process that annexation. It's several years away at this point.
Several years away?
Yeah.
Excellent. Thank you.
Unfortunately, we don't have the funding for the interchange yet.
Yeah.
So... Okay, any other questions? And I'll bring it back to the council for direction.
Move to adopt resolution 2018-065.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Oh, I'm sorry. I'm going back to the old method. Can we have the roll call vote, please?
Councilmember Durossette?
Yes.
Councilmember Lane?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Kline?
Yes.
And Mayor Vierra?
Yes.
Motion passes 4-0-1.
Sorry. At this time, we will move to council room referrals. Is there anyone on the council that would like to have an item placed on a future agenda?
Nope.
Okay, reports. I have nothing to report. Vice Mayor Kline?
Nothing.
Councilmember Lane?
Nothing, Mayor.
Councilmember Drossett?
Nothing.
Okay. Ms. Dean? Nubia?
Nothing tonight.
Okay. Mr. Wells?
Just two quick items. The Centennial Committee continues to meet. There's a meeting tomorrow evening at 5 o'clock here in the Community Center. And as Mr. Shepard indicated, the concerts in the park continue with the 80s theme for tomorrow night, and next week will be 70s theme. So we invite everyone out to attend.
Mr. Westbrook? Mr. Jordan?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. A quick note, Mitchell and Service, the intersection project is well underway, as you have seen. As of next Monday, we will be closing down traffic from Service onto Mitchell for the next month or two. So there will be some traffic congestion there, but we've signed it, and we've tried to outreach to the community. But just to let the public know that it's going to be a highly congested area of town for the next couple months.
Okay. Hopefully the Courier will pick that up and make that an article. Okay. Mr. Smith? Mr. Collins? Ms. McCoy? Mr. Miller? Okay. With that, we will move to closed session, conference with labor negotiator. I doubt that we'll have anything to report after that. And then we will, after that, adjourn to our next regularly scheduled meeting, which will be Monday, June 25th, 2018 at 6 p.m. So thank you. Oh.
Watching the party at the house.